Good morning, everybody. Welcome behind the scenes here at Jamie Ridler Studios. I am Jamie. It is Tuesday, and it feels like I've been away such a long time because I have. I've been away for a week. Unfortunately, I don't mean I was away traveling or something. I was sick, and I'm still a little gravelly, but I had no voice whatsoever. Last Tuesday, I had so much I wanted to share with you that I got up and I was like dressed and ready, and I tried to talk and there was just nothing. And I recorded and re-recorded and had hot tea and tried to re-record and nope. So I'm sorry I couldn't be here with you last week. I had so much to share. I managed to channel all of it into my newsletter because it was a very exciting time for me, and a time that really called out of me performance. You know, in the studio, one of the things we talk about is there's creative practice, there's creative projects, and there's creative performance. And I've offered seminars in each of these things to introduce sort of the concept of them. We all, as creatives, benefit from having a regular creative practice. Now, that may look different to each of us, but having some regular way of both nourishing and expressing your creative heart really helps bring the creative soul to life. It is important. It's like a garden, you know, it's like making sure you're always nourished so that you continue to grow and thrive in the conditions of your creativity. So that's something to think about. What are the conditions of your creativity? What kinds of practices really nourish you? For me, having some way that I'm moving, it could be dancing, it could be yoga, it could be Nia, it could be walking, but moving my body is a part of my creative practice. Writing. So journaling especially, I always say everything that is on your mind and in your heart, pouring that out onto the page, in part so that you can see it. Sometimes everything's stuffed in here so hard that you don't have really this conscious awareness of it. So pulling it out and putting it sort of in a long line or in a mind map on paper can, at minimum, give you a sense of what is up in there. For me, also meditation to give me some spaciousness to make sure that my creative mind, heart, and soul have some ease and rest. I still remember what it felt like the first time I decided to meditate, and I only meditated for 5 minutes. And I sort of welled up with tears because I thought, oh, My mind needed this rest. It needed to rest. And so that's a gift I continue to give myself in meditation. And then the other thing is literally creating, like making stuff, whether that is drawing or painting or writing a story, making a comic, filling out my yearbook. In my yearbook, there's a place to always draw something every day, and that invites me to play with those skills. I was talking to my sister Susie last night and saying how powerful I think drawing is, and not just learning to draw, but more learning to love your own drawing exactly as it is in this moment, learning to enjoy its quirkiness, perhaps its naivete, where it is right now in this moment, the expressiveness of your hand and your creative spirit through drawing. And one of the things I love about drawing is the same thing I love about writing. All you really need is something to write with and something to write on. You know, we don't need all sorts of supplies. Yes, we creatives love supplies, but we don't need them. We don't need them. If you, I love washi tape too. I bet you do too. And I have my yearbook, is full of washi tape, but I don't have to have it. If I want to draw a border of chevrons, I can draw a border of chevrons. If I want daisies all over my page. I can draw daisies all over my page. There is a freedom in falling in love with your own drawing and giving yourself a chance to let that be a part of your visual expression. And let's not be so hard on yourself about it having to look perfect, but to be delighted in the fact that it looks exactly like your particular style, your particular hand as it is today. So creative practice is a way of nourishing and sustaining your creative life. And then creative projects, you know, as creative people, eventually that energy sort of rises and you want to make something, you want to do something. It wants to coalesce. It's like you're building all this energy and you're stretching all your muscles, and then there's this way it wants to come together alchemically into a thing, a something, whether that is a poem or a meal or a party. You know, there's a way we want to let it take shape. Your creativity wants to take form, and that's when we make creative projects. And then there's also creative performance, which is really about sort of showing up and sending out your light into the world and receiving that universal energy back, being in dialogue, in relationship. It's not just about you. It's about this connection between you and the work, and then you and the work and the receiver. And it is powerful. And I've recently had the opportunity to invite that into my life in a couple of ways. One is last weekend, the choir I sing with, choir, did this amazing event in partnership with NBC, who is doing a concert of Jesus Christ Superstar for Easter. And they wanted choir to do what they do best, which is to bring together a group of people and learn a song and sing it together. And we did it. Not only did we do it, we sang two songs from the musical, one with Eric Grönwall, who is the winner of Swedish Idol. And believe it or not, I was one of the people who was helping him body surf. And that was amazing. And then also a Tony Award nominee and the star of Hamilton, Brandon Victor Dixon. And I'll tell you, there was an example of performance transmission, because he lit that space up. He made us perform better by performing at his best. He filled the room with his light, his energy, his gifts, and we were blessed by it and responded to it. And that was an extraordinary experience. And they've just yesterday released the video, and it's not on YouTube, but it's on Facebook, and I'll put a link to that, because it is something to see. You can catch me and my sister. Well, probably you can't, actually, because it's like a millisecond. I had to stop in the video and go, is that us? But we were there and we had the experience, and being a part of it was magical. And the other thing I did was that last week, despite being really sick, there was one day when I just pulled all my energy together, and without thinking too much or second guessing at all, I went to a dance audition. There is this big, beautiful art event here in Toronto in the summer called Luminato. And there were auditions for a performance called Le Grand Continental. And it originated in Montreal with a choreographer from there, but it has been performed all over the world. It is a group production, a 30-minute group production, and it is lively and fun, and they're putting it on for Luminato this year, and I signed up, and despite not feeling well, I ate some good food, I got a good night's sleep, I put on something that felt good to wear, and I went down there and I danced. And I was far from perfect, which maybe even putting it nicely. But I showed up with my whole heart and with a spirit of joy. And I was really, and I had a wonderful time. And it's funny, because I certainly felt like at this age and stage of my life, the days of me participating in dance performance are well behind me, though I will never, ever not be a dancer. But this was an opportunity, and it took bravery, it took some gumption, and I did it. And so whether I got the part or not, whether I was going to be involved or not, that felt courageous and brave and like a triumph, and also like a magnificent experience. I think that's a part of the key too, is to embrace those moments as the adventure itself, something that nobody can take away from you, that you know in your bones that you had what it took to stand up and try. And whether you get the part or not, you are brave and triumphant. And I think that is profoundly confidence building. And again, something that nobody can take away from you. So I found out this past week too, that I did get cast in the show. And so I am in rehearsals starting, I think, next week. I hope to build my strength, and I hope to have a wonderful time. I hope to make my contribution to the piece, to show up with my heart, my body, my spirit, my brain, my enthusiasm. And I really look forward to meeting other creative souls who are doing the same. So in the newsletter this week, I offered up this question about knowing when something is hard, and that means stop, please. And when something is hard and it says, come on, you can stretch into this, you can do it. Like, to grow requires some effort. To grow requires some discomfort. So thank you to everybody who's already cheering me on for this. I will be sure to keep you posted about what the experience is like. I am a little intimidated by it, but I think that's in a good way. That lets me know it's gonna grow me. It's gonna ask for something of me. It is going to challenge me, and that's a good thing too. So that's where I'm going to get my performance muscles in shape. I guess also my project muscles too, because participating will be a project that will have a beginning and a middle and an end, and that will be offered up to the public in June this summer. And in order to support my ability to do that, I'm really going to work on staying rooted in my practices of nourishing my body, of moving my body, of creating space by meditating, and also by continuing to be in creative practice by writing and dancing and painting and drawing, so that I am nimble creatively. I invite you to really think about what would nourish your creativity, what creative practices will keep you nimble and ready to say yes to the projects that choose you and the opportunities to shine and perform. Lots to think about today. Oh, and just before we go, guess what? I've got one star. I'm going to open that up. I'm very excited. We are almost through this season. We have a beautiful constellation of stars. And I'm not 100% sure when I'm going to be wrapping up. It'll likely be, the BTS will wrap up at the end of the first week in April, so April 6th. Then we'll be off for about a month, and we'll be back in May. And before I leave in April, I will announce the next bulletin board art invitational theme for the spring-summer season, and I really hope that you'll take part in it. It's a good one. It's, you know what? It's a bit of a challenging one. Maybe you won't find it challenging. Maybe you'll be like, cool, that's awesome. This is from Darlene. Hey, Darlene. I am so excited that you sent me a star. And she said it's called Stardust. So here we... Oh, look at that. What a beautiful mixed media piece. I love the colors. I love the textures. Of course, I love the stars. And I don't know if how well you can see just how, yeah, you can see it, how much sparkle is in this beautiful piece. Ah, and Darlene has said, finally out of my head and on to paper. Project, right? Out of my head and on to paper, creative project. The stars were glued to a twice-used piece of watercolor paper with acrylic inks and collage embellishments, with some glitter glue, gel pen, and plastic jewels. The stars are metallic wrapping paper Shibumi wanted to see. Absolutely beautiful. I love the three-dimensionality of it. Thank you so much, Darlene. And I will continue to check the mailbox. We have probably about another 10 days-ish to be in the Winter Bulletin Board Art Invitational. And I have had such a wonderful time enjoying your stars. And I look forward to your art also next season. So thanks so much for hanging out with me today. I missed you last week. Thanks so much for letting me know that you missed me too. I always appreciate your emails, your messages over on my Facebook page or on Instagram. It is really such a blessing that we're connected. Thanks so much for hanging out. And thank you for showing up to your creative life. When each of us does, it makes a difference for all of us. See you on Friday.